Lord of heaven and earth named us Israel. We are his chosen people. The Israelites received the commandments under Moses and broke the laws of the Most High. As a result, we went into slavery, being renamed Negroes, Hispanics, and Native Indians. The Israelites have been scattered throughout North, Central, and South America, the West Indians, and the four corners of the earth.
Topic is Israel from east to west. Israel from east, let's do it like this, east coast to west coast. That way when a stupid blood member or Crip sees it, he'll think it's talking about them. They're dumb behinds. Maybe they'll learn something. I want to open up with Richard Pryor. I want y'all to pay close attention. Although they do it as a joke, just pay attention to what's being said and what the white man does.
Professor! I got it open!
Good heavens, man! Great Scott, we've discovered the fountain of all knowledge of Egypt and the entire world. Do you realize the importance of this moment, Smedley?
Yes, sir, I do.
Do you see the brilliance, the untold years.
I see it, sir.
Professor's medicine.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Father. You slave.
Look! What is this?
See. Says. Cannot. This is the elixir of life, sir.
The elixir of life?
The cure for all diseases.
Wait. See here. Wait,
there's the inscription on the bottom.
Give it to me. Give it.
Open at other end. Lummox. This can't be, man.
What?
You know what this is?
What is it, Buna?
It's the Book of Life.
Book of Life.
In the beginning, when man arrived on Earth, the black gods did leave their spacecraft, and they walked, and they named the beast of the sea and the animals of the land.
Heavens.
And man in his blackness did walk the earth, making medicine.
Medicine?
Then discovered type. These were all black people, goddamn! Wait a minute! Now? This ain't. Started the music and the brain surgery back in the year 3 BC.
Yes, of course.
Man, they was getting down. This is it, brother.
Yes,
everybody gonna know about this. Listen, well, we can change the history. Civilization will be changed. This is gonna be it.
Get the bulldozers. There's nothing here.
But.
Shut up. Good heavens, time for tea, eh?
What?
The white man is the devil, the Bible speaks of. You might think that's odd. Isaac, give me Job 9:24.
Job chapter 9, verse 24. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked.
So the Bible says the earth is given into the hand of the wicked.
He
Wait. The white man is ruling the earth. So who are they? Okay, go ahead.
He covereth the faces of the judges thereof.
He covereth the faces of the judges thereof. Go ahead.
If not. Where? And who is he?
Meaning the white man covers up all the images of the Israelites. Because we're the judges of the earth. Let me show you this. Go here. Click this. this book here. This is what I wanted to show y'all last week. This is the Anglo-Saxon Chronicles. How many of you know what Anglo-Saxon means? Kala, what does it mean? Anglo-Saxon. Because y'all hear that and go, white people! What does it mean?
The angelic sons of Isaac.
Angelic sons of Isaac. That's Anglo-Saxon. Angels or angelic sons of Isaac. So this is the Angelic Sons of Isaac Chronicles, put together by Anne Savage. Now let's go into the book. Now there's a picture of a famous king right here named Alphaston. Look how black he is, and they tried to water down the image. Look how black he is, and the priest that was next to him. They put a damn, covered his head there, put some yellow stuff there. But this was a king, and this was the Book of Life, the Bible, huge. It was huge. So King Alphaston, many of you probably never heard of him, during the Middle Ages, was a famous wealthy king of knowledge, and he was jet black. Give me another one. What's the name of this book? Nature Knows No Color Lines. Very good. You already know this thing. Negroes and Coats of Arms of European Cities. Calabria, this is in Spain. Come up. This is St. Peter here. Jet black with the keys to the kingdom. They had pictures of St. Peter black. All this is in Europe, and it has been covered up and hid from the Negroes. We've gotten so destroyed now, we can't imagine ourselves king. We argue over a damn corner when we once ruled the world. The nation of Israel held down the eastern hemisphere and down the western hemisphere under Ephraim and the others. Okay, let me see this. Center left, arms of Aragon, Spain. Center right, arms of Camisburg. Austria, St. Peter, foremost saint and founder of the Catholic Church. Catholic means universal. It's shown as jet black Negro. Let's go, not the Catholic Church I see today. Let's go over here. Negroes in coats of arms again. Let me go all the way to the bottom. Let me see, is there any words at the bottom? Come on, all the way at the bottom. Okay, these are French, Italian, Spanish, and Polish families. What do you notice about these French, Italian, Polish families? They're all black. That's why many of the slaves, I'll tell you, the slaves did not only come from Africa. They teach you that lie in school so that you think you ran around with bones in your nose talking about unga bunga, umbabwe, all that crap. We came from all over because the Israelites held down the kingdom. We held down rulership of this world. Now, from 1453, when a white man began to conquer us in Constantinople, Turkey, Rome, Spain, go back out, Abiel. You had the infamous family of the Borgias family. The Borgias family, once they conquered us, they began to run us out of Portugal, Spain, and Rome. But those of us that they caught, they held as slaves. Come here. This is Lucrezia Borgia with her slave. What do you notice? He's a black boy. This was her slave who they captured. This is Caesar Borgia's sister. Let's read it at the bottom. I got it blurry. Lucrezia Borgia, daughter of Pope Alexander VI, with her favorite, I got it cut off, but it's on page 119 in the book Nature Knows No Color Line. Go back down so we can see the whole image. Right. So this was in Italy. So during the Renaissance, they caught some of us and made us their slaves. This is where you see many images during the Renaissance where you see black people as slaves. All right?
Right. The name of the book was Early Spanish Manuscript Illumination. I was trying to think of the name of it, but that's the book.
So let's go to Baruch 4:1. Richard Pryor made a joke about the Book of Life. In Egypt. Remember, during that time period, he put up that the Israelites was in Egypt. So although he did it as a joke, the person that put out the book, right, that's the one Yahusat was talking about. The person that put the video up, he thinks that the Book of Life is referring to the Book of the Dead. Our people is dumb as hell. The Book of Life is not referring to the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Give me that scripture in Mark. Is it Mark 12:27, somewhere around there? Where Christ, let's go there first. Because you get some, these Egyptologists are the dumbest people on earth. I could say it, I used to be one of them. So you're dumb as hell. We were dumb. Dumb. Kemet. Who got it for me?
Mark chapter 12 and verse 27.
Okay, is that the verse I want?
Yes, sir.
All right.
He is not the God of the dead. But
God is not the God of the dead. So the Egyptian book of the dead is garbage. He is not the God of the dead. Go ahead.
But the God of the living.
He's the God of the living. He is the God of the living. Was that it, Isaac?
Yeah.
So now, from there, Baruch 4 and 1. So Richard Pryor made a joke. He said, oh, this is the book of life about, you know, black people walking in their blackness and all that. The Bible is the book he's referring to because the Holy Bible is the only book on earth in reference to the book of life. Baruch 4 and 1.
Baruch chapter 4, verse 1. This is the book of the commandments of God and the law that endureth forever. All they that keep it shall come to life.
All they that keep it shall come to life. Go ahead.
But such as leave it shall die.
But such as leave this Bible shall die. That's the message we must get out to our people. That is the message. Okay? So now, from there, get me Sirach 33 and 17. Get me that one. Wait, before we get that one, get me the one in Revelation. It just popped into my head. Revelation, is it 20, where it says, and the books were open, that one. Yes. Revelation 20. Let me look. Yes, 11 and 12. Revelation 20, verse 12. Revelation 20, verse 12.
The book of Revelation, chapter 20 and verse 12.
Now, this goes into the judgment, the final judgment. Go ahead.
And I saw the dead.
Hey, let's start above it. I just like the verse above it.
Verse 11. And I saw a great white throne.
I saw a great white throne. Now, this is John the Revelator on the island of Patmos witnessing the final judgment. This is after the 1,000-year reign with Christ. This is the final judgment. Come on.
And him that
start again, man. Come on.
And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it.
Now watch this.
From whose face the earth and the heaven fled away.
From whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. Meaning when the Most High, that's what it's talking about. This ain't talking about Christ. This is the Most High. When he come on the scene, everything shuts down. Go ahead.
And there was found no place for them.
Nobody got nothing to say. All creation shuts down. You got some Negroes, especially black women, think, well, when I go before the Lord, I'm just going to explain my case. You ain't explaining nothing. The Most High is not your ignorant husband who you could talk in circles. And but by the time she finished talking, he's confused. Like, what's going on here? He's not like that. Read it again, Isaac, from the top.
And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them.
All things in heaven shut down, all things on earth shut down. Guess what? That includes the black woman. She's going to shut her mouth and be ashes. A lot of them going to die. Be ashes to ashes, because they could think they're going to talk their way out of their sin. Watch. Read on.
And I saw the dead. Small and great.
So all the dead were resurrected. The great spirits and the smaller spirits. Everybody's resurrected. Go ahead.
Stand before God. And the books were open.
And the books were open. See the S, plural. More than one. Go ahead.
And another book was opened, which is the book of life.
That's the Bible. So those first books is the books about you. What you think and what you've done through your life. You cut the lights on and think, nobody going to see me when I do this thing here. Most I say, hey, you don't realize the Most High says his eyes are 10,000 times. What? Brighter than the sun. You in the dark. It's like daylight to him. Yo, Michael, Raphael, Gabriel, y'all see what that nigga doing down there? Look at him. And look at her. Look at the black woman. Look what she's doing. Nobody know what I was doing. I'm just going to explain. I was a stripper because I was trying to go through college. Yeah, like that's going to work on him. Read it again.
And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God.
You know, we are the only race that justify prostitution and being a stripper to say we're trying to. Black women, they're the only one. You don't see white women say that. You don't see Chinese women say that. Black women, I'm a stripper because I'm trying to pay my way through college. And all the nation, like the hoe she is. She a hoe. She's a nasty skank hoe. And unless she repents, she's going to die. Read it again, Isaac.
And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life.
I know. Some of y'all don't think that first book is talking about books about you. Give me that in Ecclesiastes 12. Give me that. The very last verse. Then we coming right back here to show you that God got books on every one of us, including the black woman. You don't realize how many emails I get from the black woman. And that email that Captain Malachi mentioned, they lie. I get many lying emails. Oh, brother. Let me think of an email I just got. Oh, here go one. I take care of the family. I pay all the bills. You know, they always start flattering themselves. I do this and I do that, and my husband's no damn good. Anyway, I left him and I got me another husband. True story. She goes, oh, and we had a little baby, and by the way, I think I need to tell you that my husband was white, and we have a little son, and he grew up to about 13, and he got cancer. So I raised my son in the church, and he's very religious, and we would go on doors and knock about the love of Jesus. Meanwhile, her son is white now, because the father was white. So the boy died. The boy died of cancer. Okay. So then she says, my question is, I've spoken to many people, but I need to know from you. Like, I'm going to change something different. Can my son, who just died, inherit the kingdom of heaven on earth? What is the answer?
No.
No.
She went through this whole sob story. Like, okay. We don't have the power to do that, brothers and sisters. It is what it is. Are we going to read that too? Read that, Isaac? What you got?
Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, verse 14. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing.
With every secret thing. So all you in the closet, drug users, your crackheads on the side, the Most High got your number. Go ahead.
Whether it be good. Or whether it be evil.
Oh, whether it be evil. Was that it?
Yes, sir.
Let's go back now.
I got another one.
What you got?
Proverbs 15 and 3.
Let's get that one. Proverbs 15 and 3. I like that one.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 3. The eyes of the Lord are in every place.
The eyes of the Lord are in every place.
Beholding the evil and the good.
What does beholding mean? Looking at your wicked ass. That's what it means. He's beholding the evil and the good. He's watching and checking out everything that you do.
Exactly. Exact. Go back to Revelation 20 now.
Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God.
So everybody going to stand before God. Everyone. Go ahead.
And the books were opened. And
so you got to imagine this. You got the Most High on his throne, right? Then you got all the angelic hosts. And when you are called up, now remember, this is all like this. It ain't next. It ain't like that. It ain't like DMV. Next, you get a ticket. It ain't like that. When you go before the Lord, your angel that has been ministering unto you, I'm going to say it again. Your angel that has been ministering unto you is going to be there. Give me that scripture now. Who know that? It says the angel always behold the face. I want that one. Just because I know what I just said. Some of y'all are like, what? What?
Matthew 18 and verse 10. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones.
So Christ said, take heed that you despise not the elect. Any brother or sister that's in this truth, Christ warns us, don't despise them. Don't do videos talk about you hate this brother or you hate that sister. He says, don't do it. Read it again.
Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones.
Because these little ones are those that follow the Most High. Go ahead.
For I say unto you, that in heaven, their angels.
Their angels. There. Look at the word there. It's possessive. Their angels. Go ahead.
Do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven.
Meaning there's always a report on your behalf on what you're doing. Some of y'all was in points where y'all about to die. And you want to know. I should have been dead. The Most High spared you. Why? Them angels around you. Okay? Now go right back to Revelation 20. Some of y'all don't realize that. You got your head stuck up in the white man's television. Right. You don't realize there's a spirit world out here. You think this is just this physical.
Yeah,
this
they believe nothing. They believe the white man's going to save them.
Yeah.
They don't believe in what the Most High said.
You want to know why the man or the brother or sister that's physically fit is sick. You know why the brother or sister that's physically fit is sick? Because in the spirit world, there's problems with him or her. Breaking the commandments, like he said, I'm going to cause these plagues to come upon you. So that brother, he's lifting weights, he's pumped up, but he's sick. Or the woman, she's sick. Why? Spiritual reactions to things. Y'all don't realize you got to get into the spirit world. That's what this Bible is about. Isaac, you got it for me?
Yes, sir.
Come on.
Revelation 20, verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life.
The book of life is the Bible. That's the words that Richard Pryor used in that comedy. But it's the Bible he was referring to. Go ahead.
And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works.
See that? According to their works. According to their works. So the Most High is going to judge all of us on what we do in this earth. What we do. Go ahead.
So read that verse again, that last piece again.
And the dead were judged.
No, the verse before that, the part before that.
And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God.
Come on.
And the books were open.
And the books, with an S on it, and the books were open. These particular books here are the books that the angels recorded on every one of us. Mm-hmm. Those are our books, the ones that our angels are carrying. They bring our books before the court so you can understand and set your book in front of the Most High. Boom. Read.
And another book was opened.
Then he opens up the Bible beside your book. Boom, boom. So when? Now he's got the Bible on one side and he got the books on you on the other. Go ahead.
Which is the book of life?
That's the Bible. So the Bible is on one side, and your book is on the other side. Go ahead.
And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books.
So when he looks at your rap sheet so you can understand and sees all the wickedness that you've been doing and compare it to the law that's in the book of life, that's when it's time for you to get judgment.
That's right.
That's on you, you people with this stupidity in your mind. This is serious business.
You're going to see a lot of Israelites put to death. A lot of Israelites. Why? Because they've been deceived and hoodwinked into thinking it's okay to speak evil one of another. It's not okay, especially of those that believe. It's not. Christ warned you about that. He said, don't do that. Why? You don't know if you're talking against Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. You don't know. He says, watch what you're saying. All right? And those spirits are greater than us. But you run in your mouth. Or the wives they had. Okay, you had Rebecca. You had Sarah. You got Esther. Okay, you got Phoebe. Those sisters were great spirits. So shut your mouth. You don't know who you're speaking against. Okay, come on.
Verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them.
So death and hell going to deliver up the dead which were in them. Go ahead.
And they were judged, every man, according to their works.
See that? Everybody's getting judged according to their works. That's the point. Come on.
And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire.
So death and hell is going to be destroyed. There's going to be no more death or hell anymore. That's going to be eradicated. Go ahead.
This is the second death.
Go ahead.
And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
Now, people always wonder about that. Well, who's in the book of life? Let's go to Daniel 12 and 1. Daniel told you who's in the book of life. It goes back to that letter that that phone call Captain Malachi got and that email that I got. Watch what Daniel said about who's in the book of life. Crying. Some spirits are greater than other spirits. Some nations. This nation is greater than all nations. Watch this. Here's the proof right here.
The book of Daniel, chapter 12, verse 1. And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people.
He stands for the children of thy people. Michael does not stand up for all nations. He stands up for the children of Daniel's people. Who's Daniel's people? The Israelites. Go ahead.
And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time.
He's talking about World War III, Armageddon, the Valley of Jehoshaphat. Go ahead.
And at that time, thy people shall be delivered.
And at that time, thy people, who's thy people? The Israelites shall be delivered. Come on.
Everyone that shall be found written in the book.
Y'all see that? Everyone that shall be found written in the book. The book of life only got Israelites in it. You looking for your Chinese friend? Oh, they in the book of life. No! You looking for your white friend that gave you a dollar? Oh, they in the book of life. No! None of them in the book of life. None of them. You got to realize how great we are. They in the book of slaves. Right, thank you. Thank you, Lava. They going down. Now, get me Sirach 33. Get me Baruch 3:36. This book, the Bible, is only written, it was written by Israelites for Israelites. Get that through your heads. You running around trying to hug and kiss all nations. And the white woman, she gave up all she had for this black man. I'm going to tell you what it's called. It's called jungle fever. She likes the pipe. She likes the magic stick. And we see it. There's a lot of poor white trash that do that. I give up. She ain't had nothing to give up. She going, I give up everything. Then you got the football player. She gave up everything for me. No, she taking all you got. Just give her time. Where are we at, Isaac?
Baruch 3, verse 36. He hath found out all the way of knowledge.
That's the Bible. He hath found out all the way of knowledge.
And hath given it unto Jacob.
So the Bible was never given to all nations. Write that verse down. The Bible was never given to all nations. Go ahead.
And hath given it unto Jacob, his servant.
Do y'all see that? Go ahead.
And to Israel, his beloved.
Now, there's a Christian in here right now. I'm doing Professor X. Wait a minute. I'm hearing the thoughts. No, that's not Jesus. No, not the New Testament. Give me Romans 3:1. There's a Christian right now sitting up in here, maybe online, thinking, no, not in the New Testament. It changed. This is a new day, a new kingdom.
The book of Romans, chapter 3 and verse 1. What advantage then hath the Jew?
What advantage then has the Jew? Who's Jew? The Judah. Judah and the 12 tribes of Israel. That's what it's talking about. Go ahead.
Or what profit is there of circumcision?
What profit was there when the Lord gave Abraham, our forefather, the covenant of circumcision? Go ahead.
Much every way.
So Paul says in the spirit of Christ, everything profits us. Much every way. In order to have an advantage, you must have someone you got to have an advantage over, meaning the other nations. We have a great advantage over them. Why? Because we are God's people. Go ahead.
Chiefly.
And the main reason is this.
Because that unto them.
Unto the Israelites.
Were committed the oracles of God.
The Bible. Unto us was committed the Bible. So even in the New Testament, it says the Bible's only for the Israelites. You Christians, write that down. Write that down and write it over and over and over so you can get it in your head. Because they'll wake up tomorrow with that dumb thought. Why can't the Bible be for everybody? It ain't for everybody. Now, let's move on now. Get me 2 Esdras 13. Let me get to the Northern Kingdom. I ain't messed with y'all in a long time. Northern Kingdom. Today's topic is Israel from east to west. Israel from east, let's do it like this, east coast to west coast. That way when a stupid blood member or Crip sees it, he'll think it's talking about them. They're dumb behinds. Maybe they'll learn something. 2 Ezra 13. I know some of y'all was Bloods and Crips. Y'all dumb as hell. But the Lord redeemed y'all. You know, you got to be dumb to fight over colors. I can't believe it. We went to California. And they was telling us better not wear red or blue. We wore red and blue. We didn't give a damn about your stupid little things you Negroes got. Get on our nerves. Where we going?
You said 2nd Ezra 13.
Go ahead. 2nd Ezra 13 and 40. I'm sorry.
You want verse 1, Aldo?
No. 13 and 40.
All right. 2nd Ezra chapter 13 and verse 40. Those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land.
Now, I know a lot of y'all say y'all know this already.
We know this already, Elder.
Okay. Read it again, Isaac.
Those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king.
Abriel, can you pull me up a map? Now, I'm going to touch on this. Do you got new people up in here online?
I'm from the tribe of Judah, so I'm from the southern kingdom. But if I was from the northern kingdom, I just want y'all to hear what I'm about to say. If I was from the northern kingdom and I ran across this scripture, I would be so happy. You understand? Because this is the proof that I am of the nation of Israel.
That's right.
Every time I hear about this scripture, I think about how awesome the Most High is.
That's right.
That he put this history in the Bible that is undeniable. Clears up all the cobwebs and the confusion from some of our dumb brothers and sisters out there trying to debase the Bible.
Now, let me help you with something. We saw a comedy with Richard Pryor
mm-hmm.
when he said he got to get this knowledge to the black people right. and they closed them in the tomb.
Right, right.
This book, the Apocrypha,
right.
in the 1700s, the white man said, take that out, lest these people wake up. It's the same scenario. Hide it from them. Hide it. Take it out of the Bible.
2nd Ezra 13, verse 40.
Deacon Malachi, I need you to show the people where we're going to go. Go ahead, read.
Those are the 10 tribes.
The 10 tribes are Ephraim, Manasseh, Simeon, Zebulun, Gad, Reuben, Asher, Issachar, Naphtali, and at that time Dan was with them. Read.
Which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king.
So they were carried away captive out of their own land during the time of Hosea the king. Go ahead.
Whom Salmanasseh, the king of Assyria, led away captive, and he carried them over the waters. And so came they into another land.
Right, you see Assyria right there, Malachi, above your finger? It's Assyria next to it to the right. In parentheses to the right. Right, Assyria. That whole area is where the 10 tribes were carried to. Go ahead.
But they took this counsel among themselves. That they would leave the multitude of the heathen.
Now that part right there confuses most Israelite camps.
Those are the 10 tribes which were carried away prisoners out of their own land in the time of Hosea the king.
In the time of Hosea the king.
Whom Salmanasseh,
who was the king of what?
Of Assyria.
Persia. This is the king of Assyria. Go ahead.
Led away captive, and he carried them over the waters, and so came they into another land.
So point to the land again, Deacon Malachi. That's the land of Assyria. So now back to my statement. Most Israelite camps are under the foolish thought that during Assyria, the 10 tribes who were slaves said, hey, let's go. Let's get us a bunch of ships with food and clothes, and right. let's get millions of our people on, and we're just going to leave.
Right.
And the king of Assyria mm. sat there like an idiot, go. Right.
what they don't realize is that within that one verse, there's a whole lot of history that's covered in just that line.
Almost a century has gone by.
There's a century gone by. There's a lot of history in between those two points that the elder's bringing up.
So now, who can help me? How were they able to take counsel and say, let's leave? Let's leave the land of Syria. And what time period did it happen?
That's King Cyrus.
During what time period was that?
489?
No. But you're close. Cyrus. What? You remember what time period it was? What? Yes, Aparium.
539, 538 yes. BC.
Exactly. 538, 539 BC. Let's go. Where would we go to read about them getting liberty? Yahshua.
The book of Ezra, the first chapter.
Let's read Ezra chapter 1.
Ezra's chapter.
Can I just ask a question real quick? So you had the Assyrian Empire, right, that took Israel into captivity and brought him into Assyria. Y'all with me? And then Soldier Gideon brought out the information about King Cyrus, which was what empire? Ozias.
That's the Persian Empire.
Okay. So what empire was between those two?
Babylonian.
Okay. So that's what I said. It was a whole lot of history between the two points.
That's right.
It went through all the captivity of Babylon, and then when King Cyrus came in, it gave us the liberty because he had taken down the Babylonians.
Right. Exactly. Okay. Ezra 1 and 1.
The book of Ezra, chapter 1, verse 1. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom, and put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him an house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Who is there among you of all his people? His God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is the God which is in Jerusalem.
So what we're reading is King Cyrus the Persian, the East Indian king, has given liberty to the captives of Israel and Judah, the two kingdoms within his empire. Because like Deacon Yawasab said, from the time of Assyria, when Assyria took the 10 tribes into captivity, then came Babylon. Babylon took Judah, Benjamin, and Levi into captivity and conquered Assyria. So under Babylon, you had everybody. Then you had Cyrus came in and conquered Babylon. So now under the Persian Mede Empire, you had all Israel under their rulership. So now Cyrus is giving them liberty. Come on, Isaac.
Verse 4, and whosoever remaineth in any place where he sojourneth, let the men of his place help him with silver and with gold and with goods and with beasts, beside the freewill offering for the house of God that is in Jerusalem.
Come on.
Then rose up the chief of the fathers of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests, and the Levites.
Now it names them specifically, the southern kingdom. It names them. Go ahead.
With all them whose spirit God had raised.
Now that's the part right there that many people don't understand. With all them whose spirit God had raised. Those are the spirits of the other tribes who decided to return with Judah, Benjamin, and Levi to the Holy Land. Go ahead.
To go up to build the house of the Lord, which is in Jerusalem.
So now, from there, because the confusion comes, go to Luke chapter 2 and verse 36. Because many times brothers say that all the 10 tribes left. No, that's not what happened. That's what we read Ezra. It said, with all those whose spirit God raised up, they went back with Judah. Here's the proof.
The book of Luke, chapter 2, verse 36. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with an husband 7 years from her virginity.
So you had a prophetess of the tribe of Asher who went back with Judah. And it's not just that one. Get me John 4 now. Let's start at verse 7.
The book of John, chapter 4, verse 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink.
First, hold on. Let's find out. Let me see who knows. Let me see who knows. Let me see. Oh, Uriel raised his hand. Stand up, Uriel. I like when brothers do that Professor X thing, and I didn't even ask the question, but the hand went up. Who did Samaria belong to? Prove it. Give him the mic. I like that. I like that. He's trying to redeem himself now. Come on.
Isaiah 7, verse 9.
Get Isaiah 7, verse 9. Thank you, Uriel. Thank you. Because y'all, many of you read about Samaria, and you're like, what's Samaria? I don't understand Samaria. What's that?
The book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verse 9. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is Remaliah, son. If you will not believe, surely you shall not be established.
So Samaria was the capital given to Ephraim. So when we go back to John 4 now.
John 4 and verse 7.
Pause. 1 second. Get me Second Maccabees, I think 10 and 34, something like that, somewhere around there, where it tells you, because the reason I want to get this is because there's a history in the book of Kings, chapter 17, is it? Mm-hmm. Where when Assyria took the 10 tribes out of the land, it says they put in the land Hamites. Go to 1 Maccabees 10.
1 Maccabees, chapter 10, verse 38.
Well, let me finish the statement. Let me finish. When you read Kings, verse chapter 17, it tells you how the king of Assyria, in detail, took the 10 tribes out of the land and took them to Assyria. Then it says he put Hamites, children of Hamath and Cush, in the land. So you have various Israelite camps that say, oh, because of that, John chapter 4, the woman of Samaria was an African. But that's not true. Here's the proof.
1 Maccabees 10 and verse 38. And concerning the three...
So we're reading 1 Maccabees 10, 38?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
And concerning the three governments that are added to Judea from the country of Samaria, let them be joined with Judea, that they may be reckoned to be under one, nor bound to obey other authority than the high priest.
Right. So those Israelites, okay, remember in Ezra, I want y'all to think good now. Remember when Ezra, when they went back, the children of Ephraim that went back, where do you think they went to live? They didn't live where Judah lived. Where did they have to go back to? Samaria. That was their land. That was the land God allotted to them. Let me give you another one. Give me Matthew 4.
Matthew 4, verse 15.
Write this down.
The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtalim.
That's Naphtali.
By the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles.
So they were called Gentiles. Those Israelites of Zebulun and Naphtali that went back were called Gentiles. I want y'all to see that thing clear. So now, so far, we've covered Asher. We've covered Zebulun, Naphtali. Now we're still dealing with Ephraim, Samaria. Go back to John 4.
John chapter 4 and verse 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink, for his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans.
Why? Why? Who knows the history behind that? The Jews have no dealings with the people of Samaria. Jalil.
It goes back to the split in 1 Kings 12 and 16.
Right. It goes back to the split that Israel had in 1 Kings chapter 12, where it says Israel was split into two kingdoms. Okay? And the northern kingdom, they were calling Gentiles and idolaters, and they didn't deal with them. So now, we're in John 4 now. So the Samaritan woman asked Christ, why are you talking to me? I'm a woman of Samaria. Y'all Jews don't deal with us. Go ahead.
Verse 10. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knowest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked for him of him, and he would have given thee living water.
So what is Christ saying right there? I want that verse right there. What is he saying to her? It's real easy. It's not hard. It's easy. What did Christ just say to her? Make it easy for me. Nobody knows. Azariah.
If she knew who Christ was, then he would give her living water.
So does that? So let me ask you to keep standing. So if she had asked him for living water, what would he have done?
If she asked him for living water?
Yeah.
He would give it to her.
Right. So what does that prove? She's Israel. That's proving from all the way down that she's Israel. She's not of another nation. Read on, Isaac.
Verse 11. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob?
So she's telling you she's what? She's telling you out of her own mouth she's Israel. You get some of these camps that say, oh, she's lying to Christ right there. You don't think Christ know a lie when he hear a lie? Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle. Jesus answered and said unto her.
Okay, now he's going to say, stop lying, woman. You know you're a Hamite. Let's see.
Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again.
Go ahead.
But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst.
So why didn't Christ say, listen, I know you lying. You a Hamite. You see how foolish it is? This is an Israelite woman talking to him. Go ahead.
But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life.
So now, let's pause. So now, what have we discovered so far? That some of the northern kingdom of Israel did what? Remain with Judah. They came back to the land with Judah. From there, go to Luke 21 and 24 now.
The book of Luke, chapter 21 and verse 24.
Now, this is the prophecy that Christ gave about Israel.
And they shall fall by the edge of the sword.
The Israelites shall fall by the edge of the sword. Come on.
And shall be led away captive into all nations.
And the Israelites shall be led away captive into all nations. Go ahead.
And Jerusalem.
Shall so what does that mean? Christ is prophesying, you Israelites will be slaves in the future. You Israelites will go into slavery. That's what Christ is prophesying. Read it again.
And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles.
So Christ is letting you know, the people in Jerusalem are not the Israelites. Go ahead.
Until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled.
Until the times of the nation's rulership be fulfilled, meaning be ended. So Christ is prophesying that the Israelites would go into slavery again. So remember, the bulk, listen to my wording good, the bulk of the 10 tribes did what already? They migrated to this. Did we ever finish that? We didn't finish that. Let's go back to that. I'm sorry. I'm jumping all ahead, and we never finished that.
2 Ezra, chapter 13 and verse 41. But they took this counsel among themselves, that they would leave the multitude of the heathen and go forth into a further country where never mankind dwelt.
That's the key. They would go to a country where never mankind dwelt. Now, you will find on the internet dumb Black Israelites on Facebook and YouTube that says the country where never mankind dwelt is Africa. That is the dumbest. Don't even talk to them. They're that dumb. Because from the time of Genesis, you read about Africa, where people living there. Then they go, huh? So when you cut them, they look for anything to say that the Latinos on this side of the world is not Israel. That's their point. Because they have that hatred. No, they're not Israel. We don't accept them. We don't accept them. They robbed me. They beat me up. It's always something behind it. They stole my girl. It's always a reason. I owe child support.
Verse 42. That they might there keep their statutes, which they never kept in their own land.
So their plan was to go to a land where never mankind dwelt to keep the commandments. Go ahead.
And they entered into Euphrates.
Now, Malachi, show them on the map. See that black line is showing you the Euphrates River. The Bible is giving you the roadmap to where the 10 tribes went. So when you look at the Discovery Channel and these things and people go, it's a mystery, nobody knows. The white man is lying to you. He's doing what he did in that skit with Richard Pryor. Close the door. There's nothing here. Call the bulldozer.
Right. He closed the door also when he, because there's a book that gives, that goes right into this, Lost Tribes in the Promised Lands. He closed the tomb on that also by raising the price to $1,000. Mm-hmm. He closed a lot of black people out with that price.
Exactly. Boom.
That was it. Isaac.
And they entered into Euphrates.
So they entered into Euphrates. Show them the Euphrates River. Y'all see the river, right?
By the narrow passages of the river.
So now, notice where the Euphrates leads you down to, the Persian Gulf. Y'all have to know this. The Euphrates River leads you to the Persian Gulf, which leads you where? To the Arabian Sea. Show them, Malachi. Right into the Arabian Sea. Now pull back, Abiel. The Arabian Sea, which leads you into the Indian Ocean. So now, show them around Africa. Now remember, what y'all, I know, how many of y'all have ever been on a boat before? Raise your hand. Okay. When you do any kind of, okay, I know y'all drive cars. When you travel long distance, what do you got to do? You got to get what?
Compass.
Other than that, yes, comp, what did you say?
Food.
Food. You need provisions. So I want y'all to imagine this. You have 10 tribes of Israel. Do you know how many people that is? It's not 10 people. It's not even 1,000. It's could be in the millions. You did not, and it's not one ship that carried them over. It's ships upon ships upon ships. All of those ships have to be have provisions. You have men, women, and children on those things. You got to stop now, because y'all, in your mind, you're probably thinking, oh, this is one trip. Keep reading, Isaac. I'm gonna show you something.
Verse 44. For the Most High then showed signs for them and had stilled the flood till they were passed over. For through that country there was a great way to go.
This is it.
Namely, of a year and a half.
If you load your ship up once, is that food going to last you a year and a half? No. You got to stop. So I want y'all to think. Malachi, show them again. Right, but look, they got to stop for provisions, meaning they had to make stops along the coast of Africa to restock the foods. I need y'all to think and use your brains, because a white man will confound you with that. Well, where'd they get food? And you'll be like, I don't know. They stopped for provisions. They had to do that.
This is where you have to picture the verse. You have to picture it. You remember that statement, right? You got to picture the verse in your mind. Picture what's happening.
Exactly.
Put the HDTV brain on so you can see.
So it took them a year and a half. So Malachi, show them the route again. So now, pull back, Malachi. So now, read it again, Isaac.
For through that country, there was a great way to go, namely of a year and a half. And the same region is called Arsareth.
So this region over here, the Americas, that whole area is called Arsareth. Arsareth. Look that up, Abiel, for me. You know what I want. Arsareth. It says, the name of the land beyond the great river, far away from the habitation of man, in which the 10 tribes of Israel will dwell, observing the laws of Moses until the time of the restoration, according to Esdras chapter 13, verse 45. Columbus identified America with this land. I want y'all to see that. Blow that big, Abiel. Columbus identified, come on, where we at? America with this land. Show them Malachi so they can see where we're reading that. So what does this prove? The white man knows some understanding that most, that our people don't know.
The white man knows who he has in captivity. That's the point. He knows who his slaves are.
Watch this, y'all. So now, when you go to school, your kids go to school, they're going to teach the lie. Christopher Columbus got lost. He was looking for India. He was looking for herbs and spices. That's a lie. This is the proof that's a lie, because he knew that was Arsareth, meaning Americas, the Americas, what became known as the Americas. So in there, you got to just listen to when a white man speak. They lie all the time in their movies, their documentaries. That's what they do. And if you discover it, they're going to close the tomb on you so nobody can hear you speak. So now, that was it on that, right? Okay, go back, Isaac.
Yes, sir.
In case you didn't understand what Arsareth was, he said, hey, by the way, it's the place where Columbus said that he discovered. Just to make it simple. So you just, there's no room for ignorance.
Exactly. Isaac, come up.
Second Ezra 13 and 45. For through that country there was a great way to go, namely of a year and a half. And the same region is called Arsareth.
So now, y'all got to understand, Malachi, show them once they left around the coast of Africa, the shortest route could be, show them the shortest route. Would be from one straight line. It could be from there to there.
I can't see Malachi.
That's the shortest route right there, opposed to going from South Africa down to the tip. What they could have done is once they got to the shortest route, show them Malachi again. Some ships made the right, some ships made a left. Remember, there's cargoes of ships of Israelites. Some went left, some went right. Isaac, was that it?
No, verse 46. Then dwelt they there until the latter time, and now when they shall begin to come.
The latter time is the time of restoration. That's what you just read in that definition.
Right.
And it's also correlating with what we read in Luke, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. It's all talking about the same thing.
Exactly. Come on.
Verse 47. The highest shall stay the springs of the stream again, that they may go through.
So the Most High held the rough waters. That's all it's saying. Go ahead.
Therefore, sawest thou the multitude with peace.
So Ezra has saw that in a vision of what was going to happen. So now, so they came to this side of the world. Now go right back. So I want y'all to remember that the bulk of them came to this side of the world. Now go back to Luke 21, 24. This is for the rest that remained behind from the time of Cyrus.
Luke 21 and verse 24.
So now, during the time of Christ, this is what Christ prophesied. Come on.
And they shall fall by the edge of the sword.
Those of you that have remained with Judah, Benjamin, and Levi, you shall fall by the edge of the sword, read.
And shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled.
So now, bear with me a second. Bear with me a second. I want the part in here where it says they fled into the mountains. Give me that.
That's verse 21.
Give me that. Give me that. That's what I want. Jump up.
Verse 21. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains.
Start up at 20 for me.
Verse 20. And when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies.
What armies compassed Jerusalem during the time of Christ? Roman armies. Go ahead.
Then know that the desolation thereof is nigh.
Come on.
Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains.
You that are in Judea flee to the mountains. What are the mountains making reference to, Gershom? The mountains. I want the mountains. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains.
It's making reference to the same mountains that Christ went to.
Where will we read about that?
Matthew 2 and 13.
Let's read that, Isaac. This is what the mountains is making reference to. Because you'll read that and go, flee to the mountains. What is he talking about? It's the same mountains that Christ, Joseph, and Mary fled to.
Matthew 2 and verse 13. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeareth to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother and flee into Egypt.
Where is Egypt? Africa. Africa, Africa, read.
And be thou there until I bring thee word.
Y'all see what the angel told him? Run and flee into Africa until I bring you word again. Does everybody understand that? Yes, go back to Luke 21 again. And verse 21, Luke 21, 21.
Luke 21, 21. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out. And let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto.
So you had, during that time, you had millions of Israelites run into Africa. Give me that in Babylon, the Timbuktu, I thought. Give me that. Get me that right there. This is what I want y'all to see. Come on.
Okay,
listen good.
Babylon, the Timbuktu by Rudolf R. Windsor. This is page 84. Says in the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem. In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter. During the period of the military governors of Palestine, many outrages and atrocities were committed against the residue of the people. During the period from Pompey to Julius, it has been estimated that over 1 million Jews fled into Africa, fleeing from Roman persecution and slavery.
Do y'all hear that? Over 1 million Jews fled into Africa. I need y'all to pay close attention. I know a lot of y'all saying, I know this already. Just bear with me a second. Yes. Bear with me. So over 1 million Jews fled into Africa. We all on the same page with that?
Yes, sir.
In the year, around the year 215, there was a warrior that fought the Roman Empire. Am I giving too much away? A famous guy. I mean, this guy with the scarf around his neck, he's obviously cold. Come on, brother. What are you doing, a Barnabas? What's your name, brother? Ezra. Oh, that's Ezra. That's Ezra right there. Okay, gotcha.
It was General Hannibal.
General Hannibal. Who did he fight?
He fought the Romans.
Do you remember the guy's, one particular guy's name?
It was the father of Leo Scipio's Africanus.
Okay, very good. Now, bear with me a second. Abiel, pull that up for me. Let me look. This is in a book called Revelation, the Movement of the Akan People from Canaan to Ghana. It tells you the first sentence. Can y'all see that? Hannibal was himself a Jew. That's what a lot of people don't understand. Hannibal was a Jew that fought the Punic Wars. Okay, now we just read that. How many went into Africa?
1 million.
1 million. I just wanted y'all to know that Hannibal was a Jew. Oh, go back, Abiel. There was something I wanted out of there. I forgot. Go right back to that. Yes. Come up. It says Hannibal was a brilliant military genius, a genie of all times. The origin of Hannibal. Here we find the implication of the origin of the name Hannibal as a descendant of the tribe of Asher. So they let these people know that Hannibal was a Jew of the tribe of Asher. Okay? That's what I want y'all to understand. And they know his tribe. He was of the tribe of Asher. So now, during that time period, we go on. Now we speed up to the Renaissance, 1453. We speed up to the slave trade. Now you can read the last sentence that I cut you off from reading before about the slave markets, please. Now we get into the slave markets. So what tribe was Hannibal from? Write that down. Okay.
The slave markets were full, page 84. The slave markets were full of black Jewish slaves.
In this book, Babylon the Timbuktu, it tells you that Hannibal was of the tribe of Asher also. So wait, go look up Hannibal for me. I want you to see images. I want you to see the demonology of your friend. They will show you, I want y'all to see how they portray Hannibal as a Caucasian man. They always do that. But it tells you, history tells you he was a black Jew of the tribe of Asher. But they always show him as a Caucasian. That's what the white man does. That's why Job 9:24 says he covers the faces of the judges. Okay? Right, Hannibal Barker, that's a Hebrew word. Okay? Now, where are we going? Deuteronomy 28:68.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships. Go ahead.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you.
Joel chapter 3, verse 3. And Joel, you had your hand up. Where's Joel? I thought he was in the back with his hand up. Maybe I'm seeing things. Joel chapter 3, and I think I want verse 3. Let me hear verse 3. So now, those Jews that fled into Africa, listen good, those Jews that fled into Africa, what tribes were they? Ezekiel. What tribes fled into Africa?
They were the Southern Kingdom with the Escada, the 10 tribes too.
Very good. Very good. I was seeing if y'all get that point right. Now, Joel chapter 3 and 3.
Joel good. Chapter 3, verse 3. And they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for an harlot, and sold a girl for wine.
Now, this is history. They have sold, read it again.
And they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for an harlot.
So they cast lots, meaning they bid on us. And when it says they made the boys into harlots, it means breeders. They made us into breeders. Go ahead.
And sold a girl for wine.
And they sold the young girls for wine. Go ahead.
That they might drink.
That they might drink.
Yea. And what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon?
Tyre and Zidon are African nations who worked with the white man to conquer us. Go ahead.
And all the coasts of Palestine.
And all the Arabs, the Palestine, the Palestinians. Read.
Will ye render me a recompense?
Will you judge me? God is asking them. Can you judge me? Go ahead.
And if you recompense me.
And if you attempt to judge me by putting my people in slavery. Go ahead.
Swiftly and speedily will I return your recompense upon your own head.
I'm going to return that same judgment upon you. Go ahead.
Because ye have taken my silver and my gold and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things.
So the Africans, the Arabs, and the white man robbed the Israelites blind. Why? Because we had civilizations. Can you find me that Ithon in Babylon Timbuktu again about what we had while we were in Africa? Bear with me a second. I need y'all to understand this. So y'all don't think we was in Africa talking about Umbwawe, Ungabunga, with bones in our noses and all of that. It was not like that.
Page 90. The black Jews had an advantage over the African tribes. They carried their culture, history, laws, and written records with them. This assured them a constant precedent for the development of a higher social organization.
So we had a higher
social organization.
Civilization over the Africans. Go ahead.
Because of the stability of the black Jewish culture, the Jews are not absorbed into the autochthonous population.
You know what that means? We were not absorbed into that. Because many people go, well, maybe some Africans came over and enslaved. No. God's prophecies don't fail. He said the Israelites would go where? Into slavery on ships, not the Africans. And that's what this book is saying. We were not absorbed into Africa. Go ahead.
In fact, the Jews absorbed some of the native tribes. The Jews made use of every opportunity.
They were our servants. Those that came with us, we made them our slaves, like when you read Joshua. That's what it's talking about. Go ahead.
The Jews made use of every opportunity. They were an industrious and skillful people. In the Jewish Ghanaian states were found kings, princes, governors, generals, secretaries, treasurers, revenue agents, judges, architects, engineers, doctors, historians, language interpreters, mathematicians, jewelers, sculptors, masons, carpenters, painters of art, goldsmiths, leather workers, potters, armorers, saddlers, blacksmiths, agriculturalists, etc.
Now you understand, after reading all this, now you understand the reason why the white man lied when he put images up. Because he don't want you to know that you have this in your history, that you have this in your background. Because if you never knew that you were these things, you'll never try it again. That's the reason why progress is such a hard thing for the so-called blacks and Hispanics, mm-hmm. as far as moving forward. Because we cannot picture where we think we've never been. And you've always been there. You just, your people, the people that's teaching us lied to us. Exactly. That's the reason why, again, I point to the importance of video and images. That's the reason that job is super serious. You got to change the image. Got to bend our people's minds to who they really are.
Exactly. Isaac?
Joel, chapter 3 and verse 6. The children...
No, did you finish 4 and 5?
Yes, sir. Let me read it again.
Yeah.
Joel 3, verse 4. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon, and all the coasts of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me, swiftly and speedily will I return your recompense upon your own head.
The word recompense means judgments, payback. Go ahead.
Because ye have taken my silver and my gold, and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things.
So for those hundreds of years when we was in Africa, we had a great civilization. We were rich, and they robbed everything we had. From the time of Rome, when they conquered us in 70 AD, to the time when we was in Africa, and the Africans and the Arabs got joined together against us. Go ahead.
The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians.
Who's the Grecians? The white man. The so-called white man. That's who we was. This is the Bible prophecy. We were sold to the white man. Go ahead.
That ye might remove them far from their border.
So now. Now all that we've read, that's like I always tell you, brothers, in order to understand the book of Revelation, you must understand the Old and New Testament before you get to the book of Revelation. Many of these prophetic books. Revelation 12 and 6.
The book of Revelation, chapter 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days.
Read it again.
And the woman fled into the wilderness.
Now, remember, this is all a parable. The woman is making reference. Get me Jeremiah 6 and 2, please. Who is this woman? Now, we have videos on this. Y'all could go online and look at the whole chapter breakdown. I'm not going through the whole chapter tonight. Still didn't get to my point yet, but we're getting there. We touched on it, but we're getting there.
Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 2. I have likened the daughter of Zion to a comely and delicate woman.
So God calls us a delicate and beautiful woman. Go back now. So this is all hip talk, a parable talk when you get to Revelation 12 and 6.
Revelation 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness.
What is the wilderness where we fled to? We just read it in Luke. Africa. Luke 21, 20 down. We fled into the wilderness. The wilderness is making reference to Africa. Read.
Where she hath a place prepared of God.
Where she hath a place prepared. Now that part right there is not Africa. Give me Hosea 1 and 10. About the place. We want the precept for the place prepared of God. Hosea 1 and I think it's 10. What is the place? That's what we want. Come on.
Hosea chapter 1 and verse 10. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place.
What? That in the place. Highlight that. Underline it. In the place. This place that we're reading about is the same place John was speaking about in Revelation 12 and 6. Read it again.
Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people.
So where's the place where it was said we are not God's people? America. How was it said we are not God's people? They changed our nationality. They called you Jamaican, Trinidadian, African-American, Puerto Rican. That's what they did. That's the first thing they changed, the nationalities of the people. You understand that? You got that. Now, where was we at, Isaac?
Hosea chapter 1, verse 10.
You didn't finish that?
No, sir.
Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said unto them, ye are not my people, there it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living God.
What that part mean? There it shall be said. There in that place it shall be said, ye are the sons of the living God. This brother right here, I ain't never seen his hand up before.
That you find out in America that you're part of the tribes of Judah?
Well, right. Israel. The teaching's coming out of here. That you're of Judah, Benjamin, Levi, Ephraim, Manasseh is coming from this place. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you finish that, Isaac?
Yes, sir.
Now, from there, here's my question. Back to Revelation 12 and 6 now.
Revelation chapter 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness.
So the woman is Israel, right? She fled into the wilderness. What's the wilderness?
Africa.
Okay, come on.
Where she hath a place prepared of God.
The place is what?
America.
Read.
That they should feed her there 1,260 days.
So we were fed here in this place. Like when you read, give me a precept for us being fed here. I want a precept for us being fed here. I'm going to give you, Uriel, let me hear you. Yes, Deuteronomy 28, what verse?
48.
Verse 48, let's read that. Deuteronomy 20, this is what it means when it says we are fed here.
Deuteronomy 28, verse 48. Therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger, and in thirst, and in nakedness, and in want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee.
So now, okay, now we're coming with it. Get me Genesis 49. Genesis 49 and listen good to what I'm saying. Genesis 49 and Deuteronomy 33 are maps, written maps and prophecies of where the 12 tribes would be in the last days. Genesis 49 and Deuteronomy 33 are maps and histories, prophecies of where and what will happen to the 12 tribes in the last days.
Do y'all see how special we are? The greatest book on the planet Earth is telling us who we are. The Most High is, like the elders just said, Genesis chapter 49 and Deuteronomy the 33rd chapter are literal maps to where you would be at on the planet Earth in the last days. And who is the Most High talking about? Us, the people that's supposed to be the nothings, the people that's supposed to be the despised, the ones that's getting thrown in jail, the ones on drugs, the promiscuous women and all this other stuff that they say about us. You follow me? The Most High says, no, you are the true, you are my jewels. And I wrote my book about you.
Exactly.
That's a beautiful thing. Go ahead.
Genesis 49, 1 and 2.
The book of Genesis, chapter 49 and verse 1. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days.
So the key out of that verse you want is the last days. Jacob is talking about the last days. Go ahead.
Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob, and hearken unto Israel your father.
So now, I want to jump down to verse 20. Because I want to jump down to 20 because a lot of brothers say it's very difficult for them. So I'm going to start there.
Verse 20. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat.
Now this is about the last days. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat. Meaning he would have a lot of resources, natural resources. Read.
And he shall yield royal dainties.
He shall yield royal dainties. The word there, dainties, refers to either sweets or clothing, meaning royal. So, I want to jump. Now, if you notice, it leaves Asher. It's that one sentence with Asher. Now you got to go to Deuteronomy 33, where Moses continues on.
Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse 24.
Asher today is the people of where? From where to where? Ezekiel.
Colombia to Uruguay.
Colombia to Uruguay. Okay. So now, Deuteronomy 33 and 24. Pull a map up, Abiel, so we can see Colombia to Uruguay. Now, if you notice, the largest portion of South America, you have Brazil is the largest portion there. Okay. So that just keep, we're reading about Asher. Come on.
Deuteronomy 33 and verse 24. And of Asher, he said, let Asher be blessed with children.
Let Asher be blessed with children.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren. And let him dip his foot in oil. Thy shoes shall be iron and brass. And as thy days, so shall thy strength be.
Now, before we even touch that, I want to go back to Genesis 49. I just thought of something. Go back to Genesis 49. And read verse 20 again.
Genesis 49 and verse 20. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat, and he shall yield royal dainties.
So now, Abiel, can you pull up some of them? I've got some clips there on Brazil. When you look at this video, I just want to give you a little insight on it. I watched the video, and what they did was they watered a lot of the history down.
Except for one thing, it's land. Portugal sectioned off Brazil's coastline to rich settlers. But they soon ran into a problem. Plantations are highly labor-intensive, and Portugal's own population was too small to send suitable emigrants. The ambitious new settlers turned to slavery. Portugal, like most of Europe, was no stranger to slavery. 1 in 10 of Lisbon's population was a slave, predominantly from Northern Africa.
Stop. Pause it right there. What I want y'all to see here is that they said when the Portuguese came, they already had black slaves. That was from the time of the Renaissance when they started conquering. This is what y'all got to know this history. Because you'll read about black people being with the Portuguese and go, why are they there with them, accompanying them? They were already slaves caught during the time of the Renaissance.
So, all along the Brazilian coast, native Indians found themselves being bribed with their first iron tools or forced at gunpoint to become enslaved.
Pause right there also. Now I want you to see how they got them all butt naked. That is not true. They were not, they got them as savages. All these illustrations that the white man does. Who knows what empire this was? The Incas, they were not, go, 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 go. That's a lie. And that's what they put in the heads of our children. They were uneducated. They were so stupid. That's a lie. Right, images carries a lot. So you'll look at, our kids will look at this and go, yeah, they were savages. I tell you on my job, there's a brother from El Salvador. He told me to my face, if it was not for the white man, his people would be savages today. I said, you have got to be the dumbest man on earth that I've ever met. Just dumb. Come on.
It's completely anathema to them, to a tribal Indian. They're communistic societies and they work for one another. And also the concept of overproduction is completely alien. They see no need for it. They're living in a very rich country with an evergreen system, so the game is always out there in the forest and the fish are always there in the rivers. And so that's their supermarket. They see no need to store, to produce too much and have it stored.
But I want you to notice, he said this was a very rich country. Remember, it said, Asher, his bread shall be fat. The area of Brazil, that whole South America, is a very resort. It's very wealthy in terms of resources. One of the main commodities they had, who knows what it was? What dainty was it? Who knows? I don't want that one. I said dainty. Coffee beans, but also sugar. Sugar. Go back to Abiel.
And then also the concept of some one man working for another man or woman is completely alien. It's horrible.
Conditions worsened. Mistreatment, physical assault, even murder. Above all, hundreds of thousands of indigenous peoples died from European diseases, smallpox, measles, and the common cold. A plantation could see its workforce of hundreds reduced to a handful in a week. In under 100 years, a population of 4 million Indians was halved. So by the year 1600, the Portuguese, requiring an alternative labor force, had turned to Africa.
Now remember, the Indians that were there came around what time? Around 5:39, somewhere around there. So now, this is the 1600s, they're turning to Africa. Remember who they're getting. Go ahead.
Portugal had recently colonized Southwest Africa, including modern Angola. Only 40 days sailing across the Atlantic, this was now to become, in effect, a people factory.
Who was in Africa? Let me see if I got the thought right. Who was in Africa? Azrael, come on.
The southern kingdom with the remnants of the other 10 tribes.
Stay right there. So now my question is, the so-called Indians that arrived, right? First, the 10 tribes that arrived, right?
Yes,
you with me?
Yes, sir.
Now, in Brazil, that's the tribe of, what tribe is that?
Asher.
Asher. So now the blacks that was brought to Brazil, who are they? Let me explain something to y'all. The Bible, get me Isaiah 34:16. I got to read this to y'all. I want y'all to think. That verse is going to help. It's going to help y'all. Isaiah 34:16. This is the point I wanted to get to because I knew everybody would be messing up. Isaiah 34:16.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 34, verse 16.
Mm-hmm. I took them around the world hoping that they would get it. Get it?
Seek ye out of the book of the Lord
and read. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read.
No one of these shall fail.
Stop. That's all I want. None of these shall. What does that mean? What does that mean? Yes. Right there, you. None of these shall fail.
Whatever prophecies the Bible says, they're going to come to pass.
Okay. Have a seat. Isaac, go back to Genesis 49 again.
Genesis chapter 49
and verse 20.
And verse 20. Out of Asher, his bread shall be fat.
His bread shall be fat, meaning where Asher would dwell in what time period is he talking about? Read verse 2 because some of them missed it already. Bottom of verse 2.
Verse 1. And that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days.
So what time period is Jacob talking about? The last days. Verse 20 again.
Out of Asher his bread shall be fat.
So where Asher would dwell, his bread shall be fat, meaning they would have a lot of natural resources. Abiel, let's read some of those resources. The reason I'm pointing to the sugar cane, they got sugar cane, cocoa, coffee, cattle, corn, rubber, tobacco. But the reason I'm stressing the sugar cane is for a reason.
Genesis 49, verse 20. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat, and he shall yield royal dainties.
The word dainties goes into sweets. Sweets. So Asher, where they would dwell, they would have a lot of sugar, a lot of sweets. Royal dainties also goes with their clothing. Like when you examine the people, they have that, what is that called? It's called Mardi Gras, where they have all their sweets and candies out, and they have those royal clothes. Y'all ever see that? Okay, so now, here's my question again. Who was the people that came on slave ships and was dropped off in Brazil, in South America, who are they? I need some new hands. Right here. They didn't forget the point. Let's see. I want to see if he got it. Who was dropped off in South America and Brazil off the ships?
The rest of Asher.
Thank you. They can't get him in the hand.
He got it.
Whoa, thank the Lord. So, because this is the confusion. People go, well, what tribe was dropped off from Brazil? Was it Judah, Benjamin, or Levi? That's because you don't know the history. How there was a remnant of the 10 tribes that stayed with Judah. So now here's my next question. Because here'll be the question. Listen good. Well, if that's the case, if God in his omnipotence dropped the tribe of Asher off in Brazil, I don't know how he could do that because it's just so unimaginable. How come the Indians don't look like the blacks that came off those ships? That is always the question when you're on YouTube, on Facebook, because I ain't going to say no more.
Close the Bible and come down.
Only one hand is up. You see, only one hand is up. Two hands is up. Three, four, five, six. Let me ask my question again. The Indians that were on this side of the world first already, how come they look different? They got straight hair. Some of them got them Chinese-looking eyes. They lighter skin. They ain't white, but they get lighter complexion. Why? Why do they look different? Because this will be the question. They'll say, listen, they ain't got woolly hair, so they not Israel. Why they look different? Now, what I'm asking y'all is a simple question. Y'all going to get bombarded by Israel on the street with that question.
I'm going to bring a scripture.
What you got? Where is it?
Hosea okay. 7 and 8.
Ah, good, good, excellent. Go ahead and read it for us.
Ephraim, he has mixed himself among the people. Ephraim is a cake not turned.
Isaac, read that for me.
Hosea.
You keep standing. Go ahead, read it.
Hosea 7 and verse 8. Ephraim, he hath mixed himself among the people.
So what is it talking about? Interracial mixing. Ephraim. Now, when it says Ephraim, is it only talking about Ephraim? It's talking about the 10 tribes. They would mix themselves, meaning interracial breeding amongst the people. Gershom, here's my question to you. Let me get my question right. Okay. The blacks, quote unquote, the blacks came over in the 1600s, right? Around that time period. The Indians were already here. Prior to the blacks coming, when, listen to my question, when did this interracial mixing begin?
It began during the Assyrian captivity.
Very good. All praises to the Most High. I thought you were going to mess up on that one. But that's good. It started from the Assyrian captivity.
He resurrected
Ephraim that horse. And them was mixing with them. That's why the look is different. Okay? That's why a lot of them have straight hair, lighter complexion, because they was mixing from the time of Assyria to Persia. Ephraim had that spirit where the 10 tribes liked to mix with the other nations. Who had their hand up? Yes. I thought it was going to mess up. You got it. You good, bro.
That explains also the high cheekbone look that a lot of Aztecs in them had. Am I right?
Right. Exactly. Because that'll be the argument you'll get from other Jakes who know the Israel. Go, no, no, they can't be Israel. They don't look like us. But Isaac, read it again for us.
Hosea 7, verse 8. Ephraim, he hath mixed himself among the people.
Interracial breeding. Ephraim, the 10 tribes, loved. That was in his. They like to do that thing. Some of y'all to this day like that thing. Go ahead.
Ephraim is a cake not turned.
What that part mean right there? Ephraim is like a cake not turned. Right here. Because the answer's in the Bible right here. It's right here. God is telling you why the look is different.
It's like a pancake that only is on, that's a pancake that's only brown on one side.
Right. It's like a cake. Just use the word cake because somebody, it don't say pancake, brother. It says cake. Our people get dumb. It's like a cake that's not turned over. One side is dark, the other side is very light. God is telling us the tribes, the 10 tribes will be like that in the last days. That's what God is saying. Go ahead. So that's what we said. Don't get bugged out on complexion. It's the seed of the man, of the woman. The seed of the man is from the woman, whatever. Y'all know what I'm saying. Seed of the man. It's the seed that God is looking for. Everybody understand that? Isaac, was that it?
Yes, sir.
Go back to Genesis 49, please.
Genesis 49 and verse 20.
Go ahead.
Out of Asher, his bread shall be fat.
Out of Asher, his bread shall be fat. He should have a lot of natural resources where he would dwell. Go ahead.
And he shall yield royal dainties.
Royal dainties. They have a lot of resources like sugars and spices, things of that nature. Now, go back to the video, Abiel. I'm going to get through this. I know I've been procrastinating, but I'm pushing through.
Dr. J. Cliff, slave trader. A ship enters from Angola and on a single day unloads 500, 600, or perhaps 1,000 slaves. The masters were few, the slaves many. The masters feasting, the slaves dying of hunger. The masters swimming in gold and silver, the slaves weighted down with irons. Vieira, Jesuit priest.
The Portuguese treated Africa as an infinite resource. So they just imported and imported and imported on the assumption that there would be no, the tap would never be turned off.
A man went around with a hot iron and branded us the same as they would the heads of barrels or any other inanimate goods or merchandise. Gardo Bacaca.
So they put their name on you. Whatever symbol was their name, like the same they would put on, like if they had sugar, they would burn it in there, or even cattle, whatever. They did that to the slaves. They burned, if you belong to the Gonzalez family, that name was burned on your back. So everybody know, oh, that's the Gonzalez slave right there. That's why a lot of y'all be glorifying these stupid names we got. Gonzalez, Raheem, Tyrone, give me some more dumb names, Jackson. Those are branded in your ancestors' backs and you glorify it. It's foolishness, it's evil. Ramirez. Come on.
Almost every house in this place is a large warehouse where the slaves are deposited and customers go to purchase. When one was ordered, he came forward, threw his arms over his head, stamped with his feet, shouted to show the soundness of his lungs, ran up and down the room, and was treated exactly like a horse.
Y'all don't understand. And stop. Done, pause. Ezekiel, can you show us what they're talking about? They don't understand. They don't understand. Can you show us what they just said? I'm going to tell you, stand up. They said when a white man came, the slave, let's say they say, I think I want him. Throw your hands over your head. Now yell out loud. Ah! The test is long. Now run. That's what they did to the slave. They had to see he was in good working condition before they bought him.
They showed you that in that movie Mandingo. They showed you just what the elder just brought out in Mandingo. They said, go fetch. And made him run and get the stick. He said, man, he moves fast.
Yeah, that's what they did. Are we at 10:54 yet? Okay, come on.
He was whipped to his stall. Walsh, traveler.
Gradually, by the end of the 16th century, the plantations build up their wealth, are able to afford to buy foreign slaves who are not going to escape as readily, and to replace the Brazilian labor.
Stop. They replaced the Brazilian labor, meaning the Indians that were there, with the other tribe that came in, the blacks that came in. Go ahead.
The two. And so Brazil becomes the great slave-using colony.
During the 19th century, 1 million new slaves from throughout Western Africa arrived at Brazilian harbors. In Rio, the slaves outnumbered the rest of the population 2-1.
My hand shakes with indignation as I call the imperial government's attention to this trafficking. On sale are, for example, the services of Georgina, black, 1 year old, valued at 20 reais. The services of Orminda, a mulatta, 3 months old, and Leonidia, a few days old. Nabucco, abolitionist.
The continued British confiscation of slave ships and its restriction on trade meant that the transportation of Africans that had begun 350 years earlier would have to end. Within Brazil itself, larger and larger numbers of slaves were simply abandoning plantations, wrecking the whole system. Plantation owners decided to opt for abolition and hope they could coerce some slaves to stay on. On the 13th of May, 1888, the Princess Regent Isabel proclaimed the so-called Aurea Law. Brazil became the last major country officially to abolish slavery.
So, 1888, Brazil was the last country throughout North Central South America to abolish slavery. They were the last ones. They kept that thing going. Okay, it says, contrary to common belief, European slave traders were fairly informed about various African ethnicities.
What does that mean? What does that part mean? Read again.
Contrary to common belief, European slave traders were fairly informed about various African ethnicities.
Who informed them? Who else? Where's that at? Joel 3, go ahead.
Leading to slavers targeting certain ethnic groups which plantation owners preferred.
The Portuguese, they preferred specific people in Africa that were not Africans, that were preferred by Africans. Go ahead.
Ethnic groups consequently became fairly saturated in certain parts of the Americas.
So these particular groups that they targeted became the ones that they used for slave labor in those areas. We're going to read them right here.
The Igbo were dispersed to colonies such as Jamaica.
So they put Benjamin with Benjamin.
Cuba.
They put Manasseh with Manasseh.
Haiti.
They put Levi with Levi.
Barbados.
They put Benjamin with Benjamin again.
And the United States.
And they put Judah with Judah.
Right. Belize.
That's Zebulon. Zebulon.
And Trinidad and Tobago, among others.
So after they put them where they belong, they targeted and said, listen, Ephraim's over here, get Ephraim over there from right. Africa. Manasseh's over there, get Manasseh over there from Africa. Because they were killing them. They were killing a lot of Ephraim. So replenish them. Bring the rest of them over here.
That's what we need y'all to see, that there's no mistakes with the Most High. The tribes were put where they were supposed to be. There's no accident. There's no coincidence. Manasseh was put with Manasseh, Ephraim with Ephraim, Zebulon with Zebulon, Judah with Judah, Reuben with Reuben, Benjamin with Benjamin. Who am I leaving somebody out? Simeon with Simeon, Gad with Gad. Is there somebody I'm missing? Asher with Asher. And Issachar with Issachar. Right. Right. So now, go back to Genesis 49. Did we finish that?
Yes, we did.
Go to Deuteronomy 33.
Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse 24.
Listen good.
And of Asher, he said.
And of Asher, he says. So now Moses is prophesying regarding Asher in the last days.
Let Asher be blessed with children.
Let Asher be blessed with children. You know why? Because Asher was getting killed at a phenomenal rate. That's why they said the largest portion of slaves was deposited where? Brazil. Go ahead.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren.
When it says let him be acceptable to his brethren, you got to ask yourself, why would it say that? Because if we're all brothers, why would we have to be acceptable? Read that again. And Abiel, I want you to look up the Amazon.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren.
Why would it say that? When you go into the Amazon forest in Brazil, there are remnants of Indians that are base, meaning they were left as from youth, left to raise themselves, and they are like barbarians. They walk around butt naked. Many of them, the women breastfeed pigs, things of that nature. When you look at the documentaries. What are you going to say? Go
ahead. The movie Apocalypto. You recall the little girl had the baby in her hand? She said, I'll take care of them. When the adults got led away captive, the children fend for themselves and raised the kids on their own and became that.
Right.
That's the result of the Spaniards overthrowing them, and they ran to safety, and they raised themselves and became debased. In the movie Apocalypto, it shows that very scene of how this happened.
Right. So this is the history you'll have to know it. Read that again, Isaac, so they understand this.
And of Asher, he said, let Asher be blessed with children.
Why? Because they were getting killed by the Portuguese at great rates. Go ahead.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren.
Why? Because there's remnants of Asher that are crazy. That you see them today, you run. These people, they're barbaric. Look at them. The sticks through the nose. All kind of stuff going on with them. The things they eat. Eating spiders, tarantulas, things of that nature. Snakes. Okay? All is weird. That's why the Bible says, Moses says, let him be acceptable unto his brethren. Okay? Was that it, Isaac? Come on.
And let him dip his foot in oil.
Why does it say let him dip his foot in oil? Because in Brazil, one of the greatest resources is what? Oil. From Colombia to Uruguay. Venezuela especially, right. They have a lot of oil. Let him dip his foot in oil. That's what it's talking about.
It says right here, Brazil achieved self-sufficiency in oil in 2006 and went out to become a net exporter in 2010. It has 12.9 billion barrels of proven oil reserves,
right,
mostly in the form of deep offshore fields.
Right. Come on, Isaac.
Verse 25. Thy shoes shall be iron and brass.
When it says thy shoes shall be iron and brass, iron is another resource in Brazil. And guess what the Hebrew word for iron is? Brazil. Brazil. That's the Hebrew word for iron. Or barzel. But it's that. And guess what? That's not a coincidence. Well, maybe it's just a coincidence. Where we at, Isaac?
Verse 25.
Go ahead.
Thy shoes shall be iron and brass, and as thy days, so shall thy strength be.
Meaning, Ash is going to be strong in these last days. Go ahead.
Verse 26. There is none like unto the God of Jeshurun.
There is none like unto the God of Jeshurun. Come on.
Who rideth upon the heaven in thy help, and in his excellency on the sky. The eternal God is thy refuge and underneath. Are the everlasting arms, and he shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say, destroy them.
Y'all gotta see this thing here. Moses is prophesying about the last days. He says, God is saying, and he shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say what?
Destroy them.
Destroy them. This is when Christ returns, and we get on the other side. God is going to tell us to destroy them. Give me that, hold that, because y'all think, oh no. Give me that in Ezekiel 25 and 14. Thank you. Ezekiel 25 and 14. We're coming right back here. I want y'all to see this thing for you in the closet Christians in here.
Go to Sunday school.
Singing your damn Christian songs in your mind. Come on.
Ezekiel 24 verse 14.
No, 25, ain't it?
25 verse 14. And I will lay my vengeance upon Edom. By the hand of my people Israel, and they shall do in Edom according to mine anger.
Do y'all hear the prophecy what God is saying? He said he's going to let Israel wreak havoc on Esau when we get on there. Not on this side, brothers. Don't go crazy up in here. Don't walk out there smacking nobody. On the other side. That's what it's talking about. Go back, Isaac. Deuteronomy 33.
Deuteronomy 33 and verse 27. The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms, and he shall thrust out the enemy from before thee, and shall say, destroy them.
Now, let's see why. Give me some of them photographs, Abiel. Give me some of them pictures we had. This is in Brazil. Remember, what's the language over there? Portuguese. Go ahead. Look at one slave master. Oh, you got two. I see one in the back. But all them slaves there. Two Edomites got all them slaves. Come on. Look at this. The little boy, they got to push his little red behind around on a wagon. The black woman, look at her. She looks sad as hell. Home kid starving at home. She got to take care of that little rug rat. Go ahead. Oh, no. And look at this more. Come on. Y'all got to look at these pictures here. Y'all really got to look at what happened. And this is some nice pictures. These ain't the harsh ones. Come on. We got holes in our hand to go work and farm. Come on. Look at the children. They had to go work too. Y'all don't realize how the luxury y'all got. Our children from the age of 5 didn't have time to play. No play time. Come on. Look at, she had to go to work with the baby on the back. Come on. And look at this. The Edomite got shoes on, but look what the brother got. Barefoot. Barefoot. This is sugar cane and all of that. We had to grab pick. And these images was taken. Remember, in North America, slavery allegedly was abolished in 65, was it? 63. What? 63?
Yeah.
Emancipation Proclamation was 63? Okay. Brazil kept all that stuff quiet because Britain went around telling to abolish slavery. Brazil kept this thing going until 1888. So that's why you got photographs and all of that. Because remember, the camera was invented later on. So that's why you got these remaining images, these photos. Because you can see that they got the tractors and all that right there. Where in the 1600s, they didn't have this stuff. Right, that's sugar cane. Thank you. Okay, look, the brothers had to carry the white woman around because she wouldn't let her feet rest on the ground. Carry her around. Come on. Look at their house. This is all in Brazil. Look at their house. Look at that nice house they got. Go ahead. I think that's cotton. It looked like cotton to me. Right, they had some of that over there too in Brazil. Now look at this. This is what I want you to. A law stipulated that 50 lashes was the maximum amount of whiplashes a slave could receive. Can you draw up closer, Abiel? Go up. I want you to look at the whips. The whips, the cat of nine tails had iron barbs in it, like the barbed wire fence. Those things was in the whips. Now look at the slaves. This is in Brazil. Look at the slaves' backs. What y'all saw, how many of y'all saw that live Passion of the Christ? That was done to our people on a regular. Christ was our people. This is what was done in that movie was done to us, not white folks. That was done to us. Look at the backs. Ripped out by the cat of nine tails with the barbed wires. Chunks of flesh ripped out. That was done to us. Okay, the Brazilian ranch where Nazis kept slaves. This is a new article. Came out January 20th of this year. A lot of people don't know about this. Now you see in the flag, look, do y'all see what's in the flag? The swastika, Go down, Abiel. It's on a farm deep in the countryside, 100 miles west from Sao Paulo, a football team has lined up for a commemorative photograph. What makes the image extraordinary is the symbol on the team's flag, a swastika. The picture probably dates from sometime in the 1930s after the Nazi Party's rise to power in Germany. But this was on the other side of the world, meaning in Brazil. Nothing explained the presence of a swastika here, says Jose Ricardo. Rosa Maciel, former rancher at the remote Cruzeiro do Sul farm near Campina do Monte Alegre, who stumbled across the photograph one day. But this was actually his second puzzling discovery. The first occurred in the pigsty. One day, the pigs broke a wall and escaped into a field, he says. I noticed the bricks that had fallen. I thought I was hallucinating. Pan up. Look what's in the bricks. Swastika. So Germany had a foothold in Brazil also. It says the underside of each brick was stamped with the swastika. It was well known that pre-war Brazil had strong links with Nazi Germany. The two were economic partners, and Brazil had the biggest fascist party outside Europe with more than 40,000 members. But it was years before Maciel, thanks to detective work by history professor Sidney Aguiello Fijo, learned the grim story of his farm's links to Brazil's fascists. So we made, Richard Pryor made the joke earlier. Remember that joke where he said there's nobody here? The white man hides a lot of history. So why? So that the slaves will not, so that our people will not revolt. But give me that scripture. Christ said there's nothing hidden. Give me that one. Matthew 10, I think it is. Fio established the farm that once been owned by the Rocha Mirandas, a family of wealthy industrialists from Rio de Janeiro. Three of them, Father Renato and two of his sons, Otavio and Asfaldo, were members of the Acao, I don't even know what it is, Integralista, thank you. You want to read it for me, Abiel, please? Thank you.
The Acao Integralista Brasileira, an extreme right-wing organization sympathetic to the Nazis.
Come on.
The family sometimes held rallies on the farm, hosting thousands of organizations' members. But it was also a brutal work camp for abandoned and non-white children.
Meaning our children, Israelite children.
I found a story of 50 boys aged around 10 years old who had been taken from an orphanage in Rio, says Fio. They were taken in three waves. The first was a group of 10 in 1933. Osvaldo Rocha Miranda applied to be a guardian of the orphans, according to documents discovered by Fio, and a legal decree was granted. He sent his driver, who put us in a corner, says 90-year-old Aloysio da Silva, one of the first orphans conscripted to work on the farm. Osvaldo.
That's him right there.
Right.
Silva, that's him right there. He's about 90 years old now. Go ahead.
Osvaldo was pointing with the crane, with the cane. Put that one over there, this one over here. And from 20 boys, he took 10. He promised the world that we would play football, go horse riding, but there wasn't any of this. The 10 of us were given hoes to clear the weeds and clean up the farm. I was tricked.
So no, remember, around 1933, slavery allegedly was passed. So they promised these boys to play sports. You're going to play football. And they're like, yeah, yeah, yeah. They gave them numbers. Look at it says, Salva was known by the number 23. They were put right back in slavery. That's what he's talking about. They were put right back in slavery. Go ahead.
The children were subject to regular beatings with the palmatoria, a wooden paddle with holes designed to reduce air resistance and increase pain. They were addressed not by their name, but by a number. Silva's was number 23. Guard dogs ensured they stayed in line. One was called Poison, the male, and the female was called Trust, says Silva, who still lives in the area. I tried to avoid talking about it.
Look, a picture of one of the cows had a swastika on it. Go ahead.
Even the cattle on the farm were branded with a swastika. Agremiro dos Santos is another survivor. As a boy, he had been found on the streets and taken to an orphanage. Then Rocha Miranda came for him. They didn't like black people at all, says Santos, now 89. There was punishment, from not giving us food to the palmatoria. It hurt a lot, two hits sometimes. The most would be five because a person couldn't stand it. There were photographs of Hitler and you were compelled to salute. I didn't understand any of it. Some of the surviving Rocha Miranda families say their forebears stopped supporting Nazism well before World War II. Maurice Rocha Miranda, great nephew of Otavio and Osvaldo, also denies that the children on the farm were kept as slaves. He told the Folha, the Sao Paulo newspaper, that the orphans on the farm had to be controlled, but were never punished or enslaved. But Fio believes the survivor stories, and despite it being a long time ago, both Silva and Santos, who have never met since, tell very similar harrowing tales.
See there?
The orphans' only respite a respite came in football matches against teams of local farm workers, such as the one pictured in the photograph with the swastika flag. Football was key to the ideology of the Integralista. Military parades took place at the Vasco da Gama football ground, and the game was regularly used for propaganda purposes under Brazil's dictator, Getulio Vargas. We have a kick around and evolve, and it evolved. It says, we had a championship. We were good at football. There was no problem. But after several years, Santos had had enough. There was a gate, and I left it ajar, he says. Later that night, I was out of there. No one saw.
So this whole thing is going into how Nazi Germany had a foothold in Brazil and put many of our sons back into slavery on a sneak tip with the promise of them being famous playing football. So this history, when y'all read these articles, a lot of the people in Brazil, just like a lot of our people today, are unaware of the history of what happened to them. They are totally unaware of it. Right there, that picture right there on the right. That's called the stocks. When you're reading like books like Jeremiah, it tells you that they put us in stocks. That's your feet were locked in these wooden things, like so you couldn't move. Okay, they did this for some of the runaways, so you would not run away. Go back out, pan down, 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 and this was also one of the slave contraptions they put on around our necks and on our mouths. Okay. Because it seems like we got a big job. We do have a big job to do. But the Most High is saying through the foolishness of preaching is how he has planned to deliver Israel. So don't worry about, read this, Isaac.
Fear them, not therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed.
There is nothing covered that shall not be, read it again, Isaac.
Fear them, not therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed.
There's nothing covered that shall not be revealed. What the Most High is showing us is our job to reveal it, to bring it out there. Why? Because it's going to return our people to this book, the book of life. It's going to return our people to their tribes, to their nation. This is the power in this book. Don't think that anything in this Bible is going to fail, because nothing that is written here is going to fail. Everything shall come to pass as it is written, so shall it be done. It's only up to you whether you're going to be a part of this or not. Whether you get fearful and fall out, shame on you. This ain't for you then. But the brothers and sisters that endure to the end, we're going to get the kingdom. Read it, Isaac, back to Deuteronomy 33 now. And we're going to close out with this.
Deuteronomy
33 and 28.
And 28. Israel then shall dwell in safety alone.
So we're going to dwell in safety alone. We are not going to be mixed with other nations. We're going to dwell in safety alone. That's what God says. Read.
The fountain of Jacob shall be upon a land of corn and wine.
We're going to have rich resources, wealth beyond imagination. Read.
Also his heavens shall drop down dew.
Meaning blessings. Read.
Happy art thou, O Israel.
I want y'all to pay close attention to this one. You new brothers especially. Go ahead.
Happy art thou, O Israel, who is like unto thee. O people saved by the Lord.
There's no nation on earth like us. None. Read.
The shield of thy help. And who is the sword of thy excellency? And thine enemies shall be found liars unto thee.
That's right now. We're living that part right now. Our enemies are being found liars unto us. Richard Pryor made a joke on it, but the Bible says, they are liars. They have lied about everything. From our history, our nationality, everything they have lied upon. Right?
And thou shalt tread upon their high places.
And the Bible prophesies we're going to tear these nations down when we get that power. But the Most High is just waiting for that one third to repent, come into this truth. And he said he's going to endow us with power on the other side. That's what he prophesied about.
Shalom, brothers, and shalom, sisters. I'm Elder Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. As many of you are finding out, Christianity has destroyed our people. For the past 400 years, we have been indoctrinated in lies. Those lies of Christianity have not benefited our people in the least bit. Many of you know this. So, like Christ said in John chapter 3, verse 3, he said, except ye be born again, you shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So in order to inherit the kingdom of heaven, which shall be established on earth, you must be born again. What does that mean? Many of you always quote that, but you don't understand what that means. When you go to 2 Ezra, chapter 14, verse 34, Ezra said, therefore, if so be that ye will subdue your own understanding, meaning subdue all that you have learned here in Babylon the Great, it says, and reform your hearts, ye shall be kept alive. What does that mean? Meaning you must be taught all over again, taught your nationality, taught why it is that we as a people went into slavery here in America. Who are we? What is the mystery of why this country, these nations have changed our nationality? We here at Israel United in Christ, we have classes 7 days a week, three times a day. All for what? For your learning, for your edification. You will learn things never taught to you before. You will learn history, you will learn prophecy, and more importantly, you will learn the dynamics of what you need today to survive as a people. One third of Israel is prophesied to repent of their sins and come into this truth. So now we need you, brothers and sisters. Come, join us here at IsraelUnite.org. Go to our online classes and register. This is for you. This is for the redemption of the 12 tribes of Israel, brothers and sisters. I hope you understand that. Isaiah chapter 62, verse 6 says, I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silent. And brothers and sisters, we are not keeping silence. So come join us. Help us build this truth. Donate to us so that we can keep this truth on and on. Push it forward. Help us get this gospel out. Because Christ said, when this gospel is taught throughout the earth, then shall the end come. So with that, brothers and sisters, we say shalom.